Dear friends, today's topic is on meiosis. So this is a common short note for both undergraduate and postgraduate ENT students. So as for any short note, the heading should be first definition, epidemiology, clinical features, diagnosis, management, differential diagnosis if any, and complications. Okay, so what is this meiosis?
All of us have seen house flies. These flies, they lay eggs, then larvae are formed and then pupa. And these larvae are voracious, have got a voracious appetite, and these larvae are called maggots.
This term came from Greek maia. This is a Greek word and it means fly. And definition is infestation of live vertebrae. It should be live. If the infesting on dead body, it is not meiosis. Okay, so live vertebrate with the dipterous larva. You have already seen it's a house fly. Okay, so diptera means true flies. So infestation of live vertebrate with the dipterous larva is the definition of meiosis. And the species of our common house fly is Chrysomia. Okay, from here comes this meiosis. Okay, this is a common house fly. And under epidemiology, you can tell it as it affects all age group. There is no predilection. Males and females are equally affected, and it is more commonly seen in tropical countries and also in travelers. Okay, and there are so many classification. This classification is not that much important when we write a short note, but for your understanding, the Bishop's classification is the most commonly used one. Can be divided into a sanguinivorous. What is that? It's a blood sucking. Okay. Types. Okay. Types of this meiosis. Or it can be cutaneous. So cutaneous includes both migratory and furuncular. Or furuncular. That is migratory, both are cutaneous type. Migratory, this larva goes from one area to another through the under the skin. And in furuncular, it will be presenting as a furuncle with a small pole at the top of the furuncle. And wound meiosis and also cavitatory. Cavitatory means it can affect any cavities like external artery canal. Then we will call it as an oral meiosis. Or this can affect the nasal cavity, then it is a nasal meiosis. Again, either meiosis or nasal meiosis can be asked as separate short note. Okay. Or it can be a cerebral, that is named after which all organ is affected. Okay, so this cutaneous and wound. Example, in tracheostomy site, in our area, tracheostomy site, the larva housefly will come and lay eggs on the tracheostomy site or the tracheostomy wound, leading to wound meiosis. So these two are cutaneous and wound meiosis are the commonest. So meiosis is infestation of live vertebrates with the dipterous larva. Commonly a housefly or Chrysomia type, right? And there are some risk factors. You know, every living thing has got some sense. They will lay eggs only in areas where the eggs can hatch and the larva can grow. So there are some risk factors like poor hygiene, low socioeconomic status, and then abundance of exposed pre-existing separative lesion where the larva can grow. and alcoholism patients, psychiatric patients, debilitated patients, etc. All these are risk factors. And in the exposed areas or the suprachial lesion, or there will be necrotic or hemorrhagic areas where the larva can feed and grow. And also nasal meiosis is commonly seen in patients of atrophic rhinitis. Then nasal tuberculosis or leprosy where there is no sensation, or in rhinoscleroma. Okay. Nasal meiosis is common in this, right? Atrophic rhinitis, tuberculosis, leprosy and rhinoscleroma are high risk for nasal meiosis. To the clinical features, it can be in the ear, it can be in the nose, it can be in the oral cavity, or it can be in the tracheostomy site. Okay, usually common sites. So in every case, the larva will cause a foreign body reaction. So there will be severe pain and also feeling of movement will be there. The patient will be very much irritated. Okay, so pain, and in particular in the ear, what will happen? The pain will be there, then the swelling of the external auditory canal. Swelling or edema of the external auditory canal. And there will be profuse discharge can happen, or there can be bleeding from the ear. And if it is going inside, this larva will cause perforation of the tympanic membrane, and it can go and affect the middle ear cavity, leading to a reduction or reduced hearing. And even if it is causing irritation, this can cause tinnitus, vertigo. So in the ear, the common complaints are pain and itching in the ear, or discharge from the ear, bleeding from the ear, and tinnitus, vertigo, decreased hearing. Or on examination, you can see either the larva can be seen inside, or the maggots can be seen inside, tympanic membrane perforation, and also edema of the external auditory canal. And what will happen in nose? And again in the nose, this can cause severe pain, and also discharge from the nose, or bleeding of the nose, or epistaxis, or there can be facial pain, facial swelling, orbital swelling, lid edema. All surrounding areas of the nose can be affected. And on examination, you can see either the maggots can be seen inside the nose, or there can be nasal septal perforations, palatal perforations, highly inflamed and edematous nasal mucosa. So the mucosa will be inflamed and edematous. You can see the larva or the maggots inside. Maggot. Okay. So you can see this inside the nose, or inside the ear you can see, inside the tracheostomy site you can see. In the nose, pain, inflamed and edematous mucosa, discharge, epistaxis, septal perforations or palatal perforations can be seen. Along with that, there will be facial edema, facial pain, lid edema, etc. will be there. And what about the tracheostomy site? Or if it is in the oral cavity, in the oral cavity again there will be pain, then there will be palatal perforations, then teeth socket infections, all will be there. And in the tracheostomy site again, patient will complain, debilitated patient will complain of pain, severe pain will be there. Then there will be cough, because this can go and irritate. If it is going inside, can cause cough, laryngospasm, aspiration, aspiration pneumonia, sudden death, all these can happen. And also there will be signs of septicemia also. Okay. The clinical features are not that much difficult to remember. Pain will be there in all patients, sensation of movement will be there, and on examination you can remember the common things in ear, nose and throat. Okay. The diagnosis can be easily made with a high degree of suspicion. The patient will be debilitated or with the all the risk factors already explained. It will be complaining of pain and a moving sensation in that affected area, and there will be bad smell or malodor will be there. And on examination, you can see larva moving inside the affected area. There is no need to identify the type of larva as much as the clinicians are concerned. Okay, Entomologists may need identification, but for us there is no need to identify the larva because that will not make any difference in the treatment. And also imaging studies are not at all needed in ear, nose and throat areas. In breast myiasis or a deep wound myiasis, the investigations like ultrasound examination or an MRI may be needed. But in ear, nose and throat areas or in the tracheostomy area, imaging studies are not needed. So, management. Actually, the management consists of two parts, investigation and treatment. Okay, so you have to confirm your diagnosis by doing the investigation and after that treatment. But in this case, there is no need of further investigations to confirm your diagnosis because we have already seen the larva. Okay, so treatment is basically, we have to remove the larva which has already infested the wound or the nose or the ear, and also we have to make the area which is not suitable for the growth of the larva, and also we have to prevent the house contact with the flies. So removal of the larva and make the area or the wound area not suitable for the growth of the larva, that make it a better place, and also prevent contact with the fly. So first of all, the treatment. Removal of all visible larva. If the patient bystander is good, the residents will be lucky. Otherwise, the residents has to take out or pick the larva daily, on a daily basis. So how can you do that? We have to suffocate the larva. We can either go for a with a diluted turpentine oil, which is commonly used, or ether can be used, or chloroform can be used, or also you can use liquid paraffin. Okay, and for nasal myiasis, this diluted turpentine nasal drops are available. So instill that into the nose so that this larva gets suffocated and it will come out, so you can pick it out. Second is debridement of the necrotic tissue. So after removal of this, the necrotic tissue should be deliberately or completely debrided, and this is the most important one. Consistent dressing change in a daily basis, this has to be done daily. And along with this, the nutrition status of the patient should be improved. And fluid and electrolyte imbalance, if any, has to be corrected. General health of the patient should be maintained and improved. And in some textbook tell to give ivermectin, maybe in severe infestation, that is 200 micrograms per kilogram body weight in a single dose. Ivermectin dose is important, 200 microgram per kilogram body weight in a single. Now with this treatment, you have to write a word on prevention also, which include improving the nutrition status of the patient, giving good sanitation and daily dressing changes, and the all clothing should be cleanly washed and dried in sunlight, and also use mosquito net to prevent contact with the house fly. Okay. So, along with treatment, tell a word on prevention also, as I have already told you. Okay, prevention. Then, the differential diagnosis, you can tell it as any insect bite reaction, or it's local cellulitis, or any abscess formation. And what are the complications? Complications can happen because this larva will cause extensive tissue destruction, and also it will migrate to other areas. So there can be extensive tissue destruction, can cause perforations, especially the septal perforation or palatal perforation, and in tracheostomy site this can go into the deeper part, leading to stridor, dyspnea or aspiration, and also you can go to the intracranial cavity, migrate to the intracranial cavity, septicemia and death can happen. Okay, so the complications are mainly due to extensive destruction of the tissue by this larva. So to summarize, this myiasis is infestation of live vertebrates with a dipterous larva, commonly the house flies like Chrysomia, and clinically in ENT this can have come and affect the ear or the nasal cavity or the tracheostomy site commonly. Also oral cavity can be affected and mainly seen in I already told the risk factors. And clinical features are mainly because of the foreign body reaction causing pain and swelling, discharge from the affected area, bleeding from the site, perforations can happen, nasal perforation and palatal perforation, then nasal puffiness, swelling, cellulitis, etc. Diagnosis is mainly by clinical features and also looking in the larva. And the treatment is written here. And differential diagnosis is mainly the insect bite reaction, cellulitis and abscess. And complications are again due to the extensive tissue destruction by the larva. And remember to write prevention method along with treatment. Okay, thank you.